Assalamu alaikum everyone. And today we have Dr. Mohsin Nawaz is with us. He is serving as assistant professor in Department of Agriculture Engineering at MNS UAM. And I do believe today's topic would be very fruitful for everyone, and everyone must harvest maximum from this presentation. So I would request to Dr. Mohsin Nawaz, please initiate your talk.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم and good morning everyone. I am Dr. Mohsin Nawaz and I am serving as assistant professor in Department of Agricultural Engineering of MNS University of Agriculture Multan. The title of our today talk is how to publish in high impact factor journals, and I recently got the good research paper award from the university. So I will also success my story that how I could accomplish that. While we are talking about the publications or publishing in high impact factor journals, so there comes two or three things which we usually consider. I will just go in the details, but like I will just like to add a brief introduction of my citations, H index, R10 index also. So my until now, my research articles, because the quality is not only judged from the impact factor, it is also judged from the citations, like how many other researchers are citing your work. So until now, my research publications have been 979 times cited by the other researchers, and 18 of my papers, like they have been cited more than 18 times. Like the H index 18 means that my 18 of my papers has been cited more than 18 times, and 25 of my papers has been cited more than 10 times. So I10 index is like the papers which has been cited more than 10 times. So it is the number are 25, and H index mean like the papers which has been cited more than the numbers as mentioned 18 here. So 18 has been published more than 18 times. So I will start my talk from facts about the research publications. So I must start from the very famous quote that a good reader is a good writer. So unless you are not a good reader, you cannot be a good writer. And in case of graduate student or the when you are doing the research work, so the other things come here is critical thinking and your perceiving ability, your perception power, like how you are perceiving the things when you are reading a research article. So which things you are focusing on, which things you are perceiving, and how you are building your research question or the future research on which you have to work on. The second point is, the second fact about research work is, like it is worthless unless it is published. Like if you are just keeping your research work up to you, then usually it is considered worthless. And the third fact about research publication is like it is the knowledge sharing. And again, I will emphasize, like if you are doing some research work, you are getting some good results, you are bringing some innovation, and you are not sharing with the others, or you are not publishing that data or that research, so you are not fulfilling the you can say the worth of that research. And the fourth fact is publish or perish. It is very famous, like the journals, high quality journals, are where you are going to publish your work, how much the quality of your work is, and either you are going to publish it or you are just perishing. This is also in case of, like, because we are the TTS faculty, I must say, like, there is a criteria to evaluate your publication or your research work. So if we are not publishing, so with the passage of time, we are just getting the disfavor from the evaluation authority. And finally, whatever like the other works we have or the heavy course load we have, along with that heavy coursework, we also have the evaluation criteria of publishing our research work. So I must say that we have to publish whatever we are doing, and we try to make it the quality work. And last but not the least, as I mentioned in the very beginning, that a research article is not only judged by its impact factor. It is the citation or the other researchers, how many other researchers are citing your work or following your work, or they are just reporting your work, is also another criteria of evaluating your work. Here I included top five of my research articles. Two of them are recently published, and the red circle, like the which I just make the, you can say the, I shouldn't say N circle, but I must say that N rectangle. So it is the paper on which I got the research award from the university, and I feel really honored that I got the honorarium from the worthy vice chancellor, and a research award has also been announced from the ORIC office. So this like photophantom reaction for the degradation of sulfamethoxazole using a multi-walled carbon nanotubes and nickel fluoride composite. When I will just go to the abstract part of this paper, I just included the graphical abstract of this paper. When I will just go there, I will mention the details of this paper. The first one is recently published, and it was mainly my research area. I am working on the nanomaterial synthesis, and then the application for the degradation of emerging organic contaminants. So when we talk about the emerging organic contaminants, like the pharmaceuticals, or you can say the heavy organic matters, or you can say the polyaromatic hydrocarbons. So these specific organic compounds, you can say that when you just talk about globally, so these pollutants are even not treated by their advanced wastewater treatment systems, because in most of the wastewater treatment systems, they use activated sludge treatment. So the microbes, they are not used to degrade these kind of organic contaminants. So with the passage of time, they build up their ability. But if we just say that wastewater treatment plants can degrade or treat all the organic pollutants, so it is not possible. So I synthesize some, you can say, novel materials, which we can use and reuse, and then we can get the good results to degrade these organic contaminants. So the focus of today's talk will be about this paper, photophantom reaction for the degradation of sulfamethoxazole using a multi-walled carbon nanotubes and nickel fluoride composite. And you can say that the fourth, if you just see the fourth one, it was my PhD paper, or you can say the my main research article, which I again have to mention here that I am including the current impact factor. So when I published at that time, it was around 10, but now its impact factor has been increased to 16. So these all impact factors are updated impact factors. And you can see that in that case, the citation is also 131. So not only the impact factor, citation also counts. And you can see that this paper has recently, the second paper has been recently published, but it already has been cited by the 12 other researchers. So why we publish research? What are our targets of publishing research? There are number of targets or the number of aims, you can say. One of them may be just to build the author CV and reputation in the research community. The second one, just to secure your work, like if you are doing some research work or if you are synthesizing some material or you are bringing some innovation or you are manufacturing some product. So in that case, you have to have their rights. In scientific terms, we call it patent, but in case of book or other published material, we can just, or some music or some other things, we can say copyright. But in case of scientific, when we are making a product, we call it like we are just patenting, or we are just have the patent of that work. So just to secure the intellectual rights of that specific work, you publish your work and then you patent it. The third one is create a sense of competition among scientists, like who is going to publish the new research in advance, like who is the leader, who is the pioneer in that field. So just to make the sense of competition is also the target of publishing your research. And then open research field for other researchers so that they just have to follow your work and then they produce a new work, or they just have to make the same material to reproduce and apply for their research purpose. And last but not the least is to participate in the in advancing knowledge, like not just to keep to yourself, spread it, publish it, just to realize, just make the world realize that you are doing some work and you are publishing. Here I include some key points for writing research article, and I must say that these key points are the summary of whatever is the my success story, like how I was able to publish the high impact factor papers. So the first one is like when you are going to start your research article or research work, then some scientists or some very good researchers, they say that before starting your research work, you have already decided your research article pattern, like what and which things you are going to include in your research paper. So the first and the foremost of these key point is formulate an important research question. It may be advancement in your research field. It might be about the new material. It may be about some new variety. It may be about some emerging issue, and it might be about some mechanism. But when you are going to formulate your research question, make sure that when you are later stages, when you are going to publish that, you must have to define its importance. Like, why this is important, why I chose that specific research question, and how I proceeded, and what I make, or what was the outcome of your research question. So when you are going to formulate your important research question, if you are working under some supervisor, then at every stage you must win the confidence of your supervisor. You must all the time you have to discuss with him, and then you have to finalize your research question. The second one is conceptual advancement. It shouldn't be just a mere work, or just a, you can say, sometimes we, the researchers in the lab, we just say that, do not do the donkey work, do the smart work. So when you are talking about the conceptual advancement, so it is a significant step forward for a field and a totally new direction or a paradigm shift. Like, world is acknowledging your research. So at that stage, you will be a successful researcher, or you can publish in a good high impact factor journal. Then the third in that key point is sound study design. As perfect as possible, and your research question must be directly relevant to the methodology used. If you are like going to develop a new variety, but you are not working in the same phase, you are working, you are focusing on some other, your main emphasis should be the development of new variety, but you are not working on the development of new variety, you are just working on the machines or the instruments, and you are doing that, you are thinking that you are doing the enough work, it will not be enough until unless you are going for your final goal, which is the development of that variety. Then plan your research work. What usually student or we researcher do, or sometimes we just start our experiments or start our study without planning it. We just randomly do some experiments, and if some experiment is giving good results, we are saying, okay, we are successful. But this is not the case. You have to plan your research work. And the fifth in this key point is the contents. Do not just go for the traditional work. Include advanced and updated knowledge. And in the perfect form, like whenever you are writing a research article, it must be in a perfect form. There should not be the loopholes or the grammatical mistakes or the disconnection of the sentences. In that case, it will not be acceptable. It will be rejected straight away. And the last of this slide, the last point of this slide is target the research journals. And it must be prior to your research work, not after your research work. You have to focus the journal, okay, I am going to publish my research work in that specific journal, and then you have to work accordingly. Not like that you have to do, you are doing your research first and then you are focusing, oh, I have in that research article. It will not work like 100% in that case. It may work in some cases, but it will not work 100%. Then the novelty of your work, like if you're finding or writing, is it bringing some new thing in the market, or it is just the replication or the duplication of the previous work or the previous variety or previous mechanism, whatever it is. The novelty is the first, like you can say that it is the main threshold of your research work. Whenever the paper goes to the editor, he first check, like he will not read your full paper in most of the cases. He will just read the summary or the abstract of your research articles, and from that he perceives that what either your work is novel or not, and at that stage he may send it to the reviewers, or he can straight away reject it. So the novelty is the threshold of your research work. And then comes the data collection. So the data collection should be the heart of your research work. Do not make the heap of data. Just make the, emphasizing that do the smart work. Your study is only as good as the data you have. If you do not have the good data, you cannot interpret it, you cannot like justify it, and you cannot publish it. So the data collection, when you are collecting data, again, the previous point, like which I mentioned in the previous slide, you all have to keep in your mind, and then you have to focus, proceed. Then comes the data interpretation and style. The good researchers, they say that beautify your work. Do not just like make the simple graphs and go with that paper, send it to the journal. They will not accept the quality. They will straight away say that you have to improve the quality of your figures, tables, or whatever data representation you have. Then comes the analytical and characterization techniques, which I will give a brief detail of that characterization techniques, because in our university or in our current setup, our analytical section is very strong. Our labs are well equipped, but unfortunately, when we are just working on the material synthesis or the material science kind of things, so we have some lacking of characterization techniques. So if we do not have the direct access of characterization techniques, so we must not worry. In that case, we can collaborate with the other groups which have the access on their characterization techniques. And in that case, we can, like, sometimes we have to pay. And if we are not paying, we are just collaborating, then in that case, we can include the name of that specific person or the person with whom you are collaborating, and you can include his or her name in your authors list. Then when you are writing the discussion, I will also, in the upcoming slides, I will also talk in detail about the discussion and results representation. But for that specific point, like, you must have the strong reasoning in your discussion. Like, that you have to focus the target readers. Like, if you are publishing in some journal, you have to focus the readers, that which category of people they will read my research, and they can proceed. So in that case, you have to make your discussion part strong, and you have to justify it, or you have to you can strengthen it with the previously reported previously published papers, or you can just strengthen it from the literature review. Then comes the conclusion section. Sometimes what we see, what we researchers do, or what we students do, we just, like, summarize our paper, and then we say, okay, this is the conclusion section of our paper. So do not do this. Just include the key finding of your study and focus on, give one or two key message in that, or one, the takeaway message you can say in the conclusion section. So here is the structure of traditional, or you can say the structure of a research article. So in the first section, it includes title, abstract, and keywords. All three are very important. Not on the initial phase, but up till the final phase. Then in the second part, there comes the introduction, material and methods, and results and discussion. And in the third part, there comes conclusion, acknowledgement, reference, and supplementary material. Unfortunately, I couldn't include the details of supplementary material in my upcoming slides, but I must have to mention it here. Like, do not try to put all your results in your main research article. Like, if you have some results which are not the main results, but they are strengthening the other results, then you can make a supplementary file or the supplementary information file, and then you can include these results in that supplementary file, and you can provide at the time of submission as a supplementary material along with your main research article. If you are just going to add all the results in your main article, so then it will more look like a research report rather than a research article. So about the supplementary material, if you will have further question, you can ask me at the end. As I mentioned, all three parts, so I will try to give you the key points. I'm not going in the details, but I'm just providing you the key points which will be helpful in publishing your research. So the first and the foremost is strong title. From the title, people will judge that either they have to read this article or not. And also, when you are going to select your title, so it should be a condensed stance which is summarizing the which is summarizing the finding of your paper. So your title must include the finding of your paper, and it must be summarized in one sentence, which should not be more than 10 to 12 words. If you are making a lengthy title, so it may lose the interest of the reader, or sometimes it will not be acceptable by the reviewers or the editors. So capture the reader's attention. Make it lively. Make the action verbs to make it lively. So do not use generic word like study of this, investigation of this, or on the variety of this. Don't use this generic word in the title of your research article. And do not use the unnecessary details. Like, you have the introduction section, you have the material method section, you have the result discussion section. That details you can mention in that particular sections, but you need not to include all the details, unnecessary details in your title. And do not use the unknown abbreviations. Sometimes, like the metals, some metals we use, and these are very much known. But sometimes some unknown abbreviations are used in the title, which are strongly discouraged. And do not use a question mark in your title of your research article. And do not use the metaphors like, you need not to tell the story in that title. Do not use puns or the plays on the words. Do not use like the rain is, like it is raining cat and dog. Do not use such kind of words in your title. It may be included in review paper kind of things, but again, it must be very specific in case of research articles. Then comes the abstract of your research articles, which you can say is the soul of your paper. Because when you just submit your paper in some journal, so it first goes to the editor. He just checks the quality, and then he sent to the reviewers. And usually the editor, he doesn't read your whole paper or the whole research article. He just go through the title and the abstract of your research article. If it is appealing, then he go for the complete paper. Otherwise, he just decided on the basis of your title and abstract. If they are appealing, he is sending to the reviewers. Otherwise, he will straight away reject it. Okay, when editors choose a synopsis to write for selected articles, they scan through titles and abstract. So again, you can see the importance of your title and abstract of your research articles. And in the abstract, you should use it like a marketing tool. You should be quite capable of selling your things. You must be capable of selling your work. If you are like using it a marketing tool, it will work. And then if there are some you can say loopholes or some deficiencies in your main research articles, so in the review process, the reviewers can mention it, but they will not straight away reject it. And summarize key points to help reader decide if paper is worth reading or not. If the abstract is not appealing, readers will also not like. First, it will not be, it will be difficult to publish. If it is published in case, so it will not build the interest of the readers. Then comes like the last point, introduce topic, state problem, summarize findings, demonstrate broader implications or impact. Again, I'm saying that you have to, because abstract is, usually abstract is provided not with the main articles, it is provided separately. So your abstract must be very appealing. It may have some introduction, introductory statement, then it must state the problem, your research findings. It should include 1 to 2 line, and also it must demonstrate the implication or the importance of your research work, or the impact on the society, or impact on the community. Like, it must include at the last line, you must include that which impact it will bring on the society, or on the community, or on the agriculture, or on the water sector, whatever your field is. So when I was talking in the start about my paper, so I was saying that I will show you the graphical abstract, and it will, I will explain my whole paper in this graphical abstract. So in the title, if you just recall it, there was photophantan reagent, and I made with the nickel fried and with the multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So in that graphical abstract, you can see that this is for my synthesis part. This is for my experimental part, or you can say that for the separation of the material from the effluent. And this was for mechanism of my research. Like, you can say that my research mechanism of my study. And this was the ultimate, or you can say the concluding part of that research work. So I also including the synthesis section, I also included the mechanism section, I also included the separation or the material section, and then finally I also concluded my research article in the same graphical abstract. So the high impact factor journals, they demand, or they call for the graphical abstract, which is representing your whole paper. So if I just say that these are the nickel fried nanomaterials which I synthesized in the lab, and this was the carbon nanotube which I also oxidized in the lab, and then I made the separable material. What was the novelty of my study was, like, I made a material which performs, and then you can separate it from the effluent, and then you can reuse it. So it was not previously, like, you can say, observed or experimented. So when I checked this material for the specific purpose, or for the degradation of sulfamethoxazole, so then ultimately I was able to treat it more than 99%. So this graphical abstract is again the judging, or you can say the editors or the reviewers, they will again judge your paper from your graphical abstract. So one is the abstract in written form, and the other is graphical abstract. So both should represent your whole study. Then comes the introduction section. So which things we have to include in introduction section? We have to include the background and the context of that specific topic which you are going to write your research article. Make it simple and clear. Don't make it complicated, or don't use very difficult vocabulary or very fancy words. Just make it clear, simple and clear. And drive the reader to the problem, motivation and significance of your work. Do not make a sequence. If you're talking about one thing, do not mix it with the other thing. First complete it, and then correlate it with the next thing. If you're just talking in the same sentence about 2-3 things, so it will not work in your case. It will not be a good introduction section. And don't make it an extensive essay. You need not to write for 2-3 pages for that introduction section. You should be very concise. You should be very precise. in writing your introduction section. If you're just writing a long essay, so it will again lose the interest of the editors, other viewers, and finally the readers if it luckily published. Then comes the aims and objective of the paper. You have to include the aim and objective of your paper in introduction section. If your introduction section is missing the aim and objective of the paper, so it have the high chances of being rejected. You must have to include the aim and objective of your paper in that specific introduction section. And in the introduction section, you have to explain the structure of your paper. Like if I synthesize the material, so first I am talking about that specific material and how it is different from the other material. If I'm talking about some organic pollutant, I am saying that why, which harmful effect it has, and how I will treat it, and how the simplified form will be harmless for the community. So in that case, just in the introduction section, make the structure of your paper, or to explain the structure of your paper. Then comes the literature review. We are including the same section in the introduction part. This literature review, we are not providing it separately. In some cases, when the journal demands to provide it on separate basis, then we do. Otherwise, we just include the literature review in the introduction section. So when you are citing some papers, so make sure that sometimes you have to make it, sometimes you have to judge it, like either you have to include this in your introduction section or not. Sometimes it is very straight away, you add it and it works, but sometimes it doesn't. So the references which we are adding in literature review, these all references must be accessible. There should not be any reference which you cite in the literature review and it is not in your bibliography. And if it is present in the bibliography and it is not present in your text. So one thing is, like, you have to double check either your all cited references are present in the bibliography. If it is, then okay. And also make sure that all your research references are accessible. And use the updated and advanced literature. Do not use the obsolete or the outdated knowledge. Okay. If you are reporting some specific methodology which was like developed in 1990 and it is still working and there are some modifications in that, you can quote that specific methodology, but in other cases you have to refer to the updated knowledge. Then comes the material and method section. You have to include all the materials you use in your experimentation or in your research study. And the readers, you have to write your methods or the methodology in that way that if somebody wants to reproduce it, he or she can easily reproduce your work by referring your material or the material and method section. And if some steps are missing in your paper, you may refer it to the other source from where you just followed that method, but you don't want to include in your paper. In that case, you can just cite the reference of that paper. Like this method can be accessed from Flan journal. Okay, and R formulae and values must be accurately reported, and do not provide any chance to reviewers to comment that your material and method section is incomplete. Because if he or she, he thinks that the work, research work cannot be reproduced, so the reviewer straight away, he will say that you have to complete your material and method section. Then comes the results and discussion section. You have to represent your results either in tabular form or figures, whichever is suitable, relevant to your field. Sometimes the table works, sometimes the figure works, but you have to see the target journal and also your target field, that in which field you are going to publish or in which field you are working. Do not repeat your results. Like if you are describing or explaining the same results in the text form and the same is present in the figure, so again there will be the duplication of your duplication of your data. So don't repeat your results. Either keep it in tabular form or in text form or in figure form. So don't repeat the results again, I'm saying. And previously I already told you that beautify your results and use the best available software and tools. If previously when we were making the graphs, we were using the Microsoft Excel, but now very advanced softwares you have, and you have to switch on that particular softwares or tools. You shouldn't stick to the outdated or the obsolete versions. And the statistical authentication of your results have utmost importance. If you are not providing the statistical analysis in your study, again, it will not work. And translate your findings into accessible and meaningful information. And again, discussion must have strong reasoning, and you have to refer to the updated knowledge, not the outdated knowledge. And build consistency and proper sequence. I told you that if you are not making the proper sentence structure or the sequence in your study, or if you are not writing the things in proper structure, again, it will not work. So this is all about results and discussion section. In the start, I told you that I will include some characterization techniques, which I included in my research article, and it was relevant to my field. I will not say that it will be these are generalized form, but if we have to work in nanomaterials or the material synthesis, or for the degradation kind of studies, or specifically for the material characterization, we have to have these kind of instruments in our if I just talk about FTIR, we already got FTIR in our central lab. So from these, if we do not have access to all the instruments or the characterization instruments, so we can collaborate with some other department or with some other institution where these facilities are available. And if we are working in the specific field, then the collaboration will also work, because it helps to beautify your study. You can see that here I added the X-ray diffraction and FTIR analysis in my study, and it strengthened it, and it was helpful to publish in the high impact literature journal. Then I included the XPS, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, and again you can see that these are for the material characterization, and these results were working very well for publishing in high impact literature journal. Again, we have the scanning electron microscope. On the nanoscale, I saw my material that how the only the nickel fried particles, how they look like, and how the carbon nanotubes look like. And when I made the composite, if you just see the composite, how the composite look like. So at the nanoscale, the demonstration was available, which was again helpful to strengthen my research part. Again, there was some transmission electron microscope and images I added just to strengthen my results. And then there was the material which I used at the synthesis level. I checked it on the final stage, that either they are present in that material or not, and in which form they are present. So again, it was helpful in publishing or for my paper being accepted in chemical engineering journal. There was also the thermogravimetric analysis. Like I just saw that if I am working only with nickel fried nanoparticles, how it will work. And if I am working with the nickel fried with the carbon nanotubes, how the material is degrading with the temperature, like if with the increase in temperature, either the material is burning or it is stable. So it was quite helpful for me in that case. It was very helpful in publishing. And again, I'm emphasizing that for the characterization techniques, we must have to build our collaborations with the other institute. Also for the BET analysis, this is the surface area of the material. When we are working with the adsorption kind of things or degradation kind of things, again, we focus on these kind of things, and it was again helpful. And there was also, because this material was magnetic and it was easily separable from the effluent. So again, I showed in my paper, and it was again helpful. Finally, I will just conclude my presentation with the conclusion, acknowledgement, and reference section. You have to link your conclusion to the objectives of your study. And you have to identify any limitation, and you can make the recommendation. If there are some limitation in your study, you can again and make the recommendations for the future work, or you can just say that these things I can do in my future work specifically. And or you can say that it still has some provision to work on in future. Then discuss any implication or impacts for theory or practice, and properly acknowledge the funding source. And if due to some reason you are not able to include the contributors in the author list, you must have to acknowledge their contribution in the acknowledgement section. And then cite the accessible and updated reference. It is about the reference. And you must have to follow the reference style of the journal, because in the author guide pack, they have all the guidelines for the author. You must have to read of that specific journal, and you have to follow all the guidelines in that. Then you have the high chance of publishing in high impact literature journal. So this is all from my side. I must acknowledge the the contribution, or you can say that of Dr. Alamgir Rehan Khan here, because when this paper was published, he was the chairman of the Department of Agricultural Engineering, and he was so kind to me that he allowed me to give extra time for this publication or the revision process. So I must acknowledge his kindness and his guidance at each and every step. So this is all from my side. If you have question, the session is open for question, please.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for today's session. It was really a wonderful session, and I must believe that a lot of young researchers and students must have learned a lot from your success story. So the house is open. So the floor is open. If anyone want to have some question regarding this topic, he or she can ask the question. And for, first of all, I want to ask some question from Dr. Mohsin Nawaz.
Yes,
sir. Sir, what should be the criteria to select a journal?
Yes. Because I told you, during my presentation, when you are going to start your research work, it must be selected at that specific time. And you have to see in which area you are working and what kind of research is publishing in that specific kind of journal. When you are going to target a journal, you have to specify the area first. Like if you are working in agriculture sector, then you have to find the specific or the prestigious journal in that specific category. And do not go for the low impact factor journal. Always keep your ambitions high. Always go for the prestigious and high impact factor journal in your specific area. If you in your specific area, if you are seeing that this journal is publishing very good research, then you can target that specific journal. And for that, you must be a good reader of that specific journal, or you must be a good reader of all the journals of your field. So when you are a good reader of your specific area or your field, then you have the ease to select that target journal. I hope that I have answered your question. If there is a further question from your side, please.
Sir, according to you, what do you say that the impact factor is the only criteria from which we can judge the repute of a journal?
No, actually, in the impact factor case, yes, it is the criteria. But again, you cannot generalize it, because if in the medical sector, there are very, very high impact factor journals, but the number of publications are very less in that. And for publishing in that specific journals, you have to be very novel. But if in agriculture sector, if there are not the high impact factor journal of that same type or same category, then you cannot compare two fields with the impact factor. Okay, in agriculture side there will be separate criteria. On medical side there will be specific criteria. If they are a very high impact factor journal, so it is not the case in agriculture sector, then you cannot say that this is not the good journal. If in agriculture sector there is three impact factor journal and it is very prestigious and their work is highly acknowledged, then you can select that journal. Otherwise, if you are working in material synthesis, then there are again very good journals, and their impact factor is based in that specific field. So do not compare all the journals with the impact factor. Field to field, it varies.
Okay, thank you, sir. So if anyone want to have some question from the student, from the faculty, so there is an opportunity to ask the question.
And I must have to announce here that I am open for any kind of collaboration or any kind of, if some student he want, I'm already working with some faculty members. I'm collaborating with them, and already I am co-supervising, because in my department there are not masters or PhD students available. So I am just collaborating with my colleagues. But again, I must openly say that I am open for any kind of collaboration or supervision. So if some students are interested to work with me, I will be happily available to guide them or to build their research career.
Yes, Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohsen, for a very nice presentation. In my opinion, I think the most difficult part of an article is the discussion. And the traditional way of writing discussion is, you give a very general statement at the start in a discussion section, and then you gave some references which second your opinion or object your opinion, and then at the end you give some logical reasoning. So this is the very traditional way to write discussion. Could you please add something new to write a very impressive discussion? What could be the other things which are very important in writing discussion part of
your application? Thank you for your nice question. Actually, the main thing always the researcher or the good scientist, you can say, they say that you must have a strong and logical reasoning of your whatever you are going to write in your discussion part. One thing is the strong and logic reasoning, and the second thing is either your study is in accordance or contrary to the previously published research. Because whenever you are going to publish in high impact factor journals, you are bringing some new paradigm. So the thing is, first thing is strong and logic reasoning, and the second thing is you have to check it, check your results when you're writing your discussion part. You have to check your results that either the results are contrary or in accordance with the previous study. This is again the traditional way, but it works in most of the cases. But the strong and logic reasoning always work. Sir, did I answer your question? Or
yeah, that's fine. That's fine. Thank you very much. That
was yes. Thank you, sir.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Mohsin. How are you?
Yes, ma'am, I'm good. Alhamdulillah.
Thank you so much. बहुत अच्छी presentation दी आपने और a few of my students are here. तो मैं उनको भी मैंने बल्कि बहुत उनको इंसिस्ट किया कि ये वाला सेशन ज़रूर अटेंड करें. इसमें एक चीज़ जो नॉर्मली आई हैव सीन इज़ डैट लिटरेचर रिव्यू को हम लोग काफ़ी लाइक उसको भी डोंट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज़ एक्चुअली लिटरेचर रिव्यू. तो होता ये है कि नॉर्मली स्टूडेंट्स या ओवरऑल हम लोग रिसर्चर्स ये करते हैं कि सिर्फ पॉइंट्स में लिख देते हैं, लाइक द papers that we have read, we just describe them a bit and then just leave it. So actually aapka jo ek point tha wo bahut acha tha ki aapne arguments ko build karna hai actually aur uske hisab se aapne apne literature ko structure karna hai. So it's all about the literature should revolve around your ideas. It's not like just you point out all these things. Aap isko thoda sa explain mazid kar denge students ko bhi ki literature review ko kis tarah se likhna chahiye.
Ji ma'am. एक्चुअली जब भी हम लिटरेचर रिव्यू कर रहे होते हैं तो हम मैंने जैसे बताया कि रिसर्च और ग्रेजुएट्स लेवल पे या जब आप मास्टर्स या पीएचडी स्टूडेंट हो जाते हैं तो जब आप एक पेपर रीड कर रहे होते हैं तो आपने स्ट्रेट अवे उसी स्टेटमेंट को अपने पेपर में इंक्लूड नहीं कर देना होता. मैंने जैसे बताया था कि क्रिटिकल, यू मस्ट बी क्रिटिकल थिंकर एंड ऑल्सो यू हैव टू परसीव इट के उसके पीछे आइडिया क्या है. और आप जो स्पेसिफिकली अपने पेपर में लिखने जा रहे हैं आया वो ऑलरेडी रिपोर्ट हो चुका है. अगर रिपोर्ट हो चुका है तो आप अपनी स्टडी को स्ट्रेंथन कर सकते हैं उससे. आप उनके रेफरेंस दे सकते हैं कि जी फलां फलां हाई इम्पैक्ट फैक्टर जर्नल में या इस जर्नल में ये ऑलरेडी जो है वो रिपोर्ट हो चुका है. और फिर आपने साथ में सेम टाइम पे आपने ये भी बताना है कि हाउ योर रिसर्च इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम दैट. नो डाउट कि आपकी जो एग्जिस्टिंग रिसर्च है वो आपको वेरीफाई तो कर रही है प्रीवियस रेफरेंसेस को, लेकिन दिलावर साहब अगर काइंडली आप माइक ऑफ कर लेंगे. ओके, आई मस्ट कंटिन्यू कि उसमें यह है जो कि आपकी रिसर्च जो करंट रिसर्च है वो पिछली रिसर्च हो चुकी है या पब्लिश हो चुका है उसको तो फुलफिल कर रही है, उस क्राइटेरिया को फुलफिल कर रही है, लेकिन आप उसमें जो है नोवेलिटी क्या लेके आ रहे हैं, आप उसमें क्या नई चीज लेके आ रहे हैं जो पुराने डाटे से नो डाउट उसको मिल गई आपको, लेकिन आपने नई चीज क्या लेके आई, आपने उसको कैसे आगे लेके चलना है. इसलिए अगर सिंपल एक स्टेटमेंट आती है कि दिस प्रोडक्ट हैज बीन डेवलप्ड, सो और आप स्टेट अवे उसे उठाकर अपने पेपर में लिख देते हैं जी कि फ्रॉम दैट पेपर आई फाउंड दैट दिस प्रोडक्ट हैज बीन मेड, सो दिस विल नॉट बी इनफ. यू हैव टू कोरिलेटेड विद योर स्टडी कि जी मैंने ये काम किया है, ठीक है, और पहले ये काम इस तरह हो चुका था और मैं उसमें ये नोवेलिटी या इनोवेशन लेके आया हूं. इसलिए आपने उसे सर्कल करना होता है, ना कि आपने सेम स्टेटमेंट्स को उठा के उसमें पेपर में ऐड कर देना होता है. आई होप मैम के कुछ मैं सक्सेसफुल हुआ होऊंगा आंसर देने में, लेकिन
डेफिनेटली थैंक यू सो मच.
यू वेलकम.
मैं कुछ कह सकता हूँ इस?
जी जी श्योर सर, श्योर
जी सर, जी सर, जी सर प्लीज.
एक तो छोटा सा मतलब अपना जो पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंस इन राइटिंग सम पब्लिकेशंस, रिजल्ट्स के अंदर मेनली प्रॉब्लम होता है स्टूडेंट्स वही चीज़ें जो आपने भी बात की रेपिटेशन की के एक तो है कि समटाइम्स जैसे हम थीसिस में देखते हैं एक दफ़ा वो ग्राफिकल बार्स डायग्राम बना देते हैं, दूसरा साथ में वो कोशिश करते हैं जी के उसका टेबल भी दे दिया जाए, तो दिस इज प्योरली द रेपिटेशन। तो आप एक चीज यूज करें चाहे टेबल यूज करें या अगर आप ग्राफिकल कोई प्रेजेंट उसमें कर रहे हैं प्रेजेंट, बट जनरली ग्राफिकल प्रेजेंटेशन दे आर मोर लेबोरेटिव एंड एक्सप्रेसिव देन टेबल्स, लेकिन ये नेचर के ऊपर डिपेंड करते हैं। तो आपने जो टेक्स्ट के अंदर स्टूडेंट्स को चाहिए कि ये उसकी जो इन टर्म्स ऑफ परसेंट इंक्रीज या डिक्रीज किस जो कंट्रोल है उस इस चीज को ज्यादा फोकस करना चाहिए, या अगर बहुत ज्यादा इंक्रीज डिक्रीज है दे कैन मेंशन इट इन टर्म्स ऑफ फोल्ड इंक्रीज और डिक्रीज। तो बजाय इसके कि हम वही जो ट्रेडिशनली तरीकेकार एक लिखते हैं कि ये मैक्सिमम वैल्यू है दिस इज दिस वॉज द मिनिमम वैल्यू, उससे हटके थोड़ा आपको इन टर्म्स ऑफ परसेंट इंक्रीज या डिक्रीज और सिमिलरली या फोल्ड अप फोल्ड इंक्रीज टू फोल्ड इंक्रीज थ्री फोल्ड इंक्रीज तो इन टर्म्स के अंदर उसको मेंशन करें तो ज्यादा वो एक्सप्रेसिव हो सकते हैं। इस तरह एक और कमेंट जो बात हो रही थी इन टर्म्स ऑफ इंपैक्ट फैक्टर, तो एक और चीज जो है ना फॉर एग्जांपल वो जनरल जो है वो कहाँ पे फॉल कर रहा है, टॉप 50% के अंदर फॉल कर रहा है उस कैटेगरी में जिस कैटेगरी के अंदर आप पब्लिश करने जा रहे हो जर्नल्स जो है टोटल उस कैटेगरी में, तो उसके अंदर वो अगर टॉप जो 50% है उसके अंदर फॉल कर रहा है तो दिस इज अनदर क्राइटेरिया टू मीन असेस द क्वालिटी ऑफ योर पब्लिकेशन वर्क। ये भी एक क्राइटेरिया है बेशक इम्पैक्ट फैक्टर जो भी है, बट अगर फॉर एग्जाम्पल 25 जर्नल्स हैं उस कैटेगरी उस फील्ड के अंदर और वो ऊपर वाले जो आप क्लासिफिकेशन मिल जाती है ऊपर वाले 10 नंबर पे 12 नंबर जो जर्नल है उसके अंदर पब्लिश हुआ है तो दैट्स गुड। तो इसी प्लेटफॉर्म से एक और जो अनाउंसमेंट मैं करना चाह रहा हूँ कि नेक्स्ट इन द नेक्स्ट GRC हमने इन्वाइट किया है is one of the very famous Australian expert Professor Rana Muns jo stress physiology mein ek bahut bada naam hai duniya ke shayad jo few top ranked scientists hain unke andar shumar hote hain and she will presenting on scientific writing skills and publishing tips in the next GRC। तो स्टूडेंट्स को और सब फैकल्टी को चाहिए कि वो नेक्स्ट GRC के अंदर भी तशरीफ लेके आए ज्वाइन करें हमें। तो थैंक यू वेरी मच, सो नाइस ऑफ यू।
एक सर ने क्राइटेरिया इसमें मेंशन कर दिया टॉप 10% 15% का, आजकल Q1 Q2 कैटेगरी ये भी सर आजकल जो है ना सिलसिला चल रहा है, तो मीन के अभी जो 12 कंट्रीज हैं या जिनकी यूनिवर्सिटीज रैंकिंग में अच्छी हैं उन्होंने अब जो क्राइटेरिया अडॉप्ट किया है उसमें Q1 कैटेगरी होना चाहिए, टॉप 10-15% होना चाहिए, हाई इंपैक्ट फैक्टर, तो ये 3-4 क्राइटेरिया उन्होंने जो है एट द सेम टाइम जो है वो साथ में इंक्लूड कर दिए।
जी जी बिल्कुल, थैंक यू।
थैंक यू
जी सर। और इसी तरह मैं भी स्मैट करना चाहूंगा, सर तनवीर ने बात की ग्राफिकल रिप्रेजेंटेशन बहुत जरूरी है आपने डाटा को प्रेजेंट करने के लिए, इसमें एडिशन यह भी हम करेंगे जो स्टूडेंट्स को चाहिए या जो हम रिसर्चर हैं हमको भी चाहिए कि अपने ग्राफ की क्वालिटी पे कॉम्प्रोमाइज ना करें हम।
एग्जैक्टली
समझा दिए, यस इट शुड बी विजुअली अपीलिंग, हमारा कलर स्कीम ऐसे चूज करनी चाहिए हमें ऐसा उसको इतना अट्रैक्टिव बनाएं कि वो हमारे ही आर्टिकल की मार्केटिंग कोई ग्राफ कर रहा हो। सर आपने जिक्र किया कि एब्स्ट्रैक्ट के अंदर आप हमें ऐसा लिखना चाहिए कि एब्स्ट्रैक्ट मार्केट आवर रिसर्च आर्टिकल, तो हमारे ग्राफिकल रिप्रेजेंटेशन भी ऐसी हो कि हम उसको वो हमारे आर्टिकल को मार्केट करें। एंड सेकेंडली सर ये जो HEC का क्राइटेरिया है W कैटेगरी X कैटेगरी Y कैटेगरी ये इसके ऊपर सर आप आखिर में थोड़ी सी बात कर दें सर कि ये क्या चीज़ होगी सर।
हाँ जी, एक्चुअली HEC ने अपना HERS जो है वो पोर्टल बनाया है, और उसमें जो जी कैटेगरी के हैं, मींस कि हम जी से स्टार्ट नीचे से ऊपर आते हैं, जी कैटेगरी वाले जो आर्टिकल्स हैं उनको वो नहीं कंसीडर करते हैं. कंसीडर इन द सेंस के हमारा अगर एवेल्युएशन होती है और हमारा, या फिर हम किसी जॉब के लिए अप्लाई करते हैं, तो उसमें एक्स जी कैटेगरी के जो हैं वो बिल्कुल उसमें नलीफाई हो जाएंगे. वाई कैटेगरी से ऊपर वाले जो जर्नल हैं वो उन्होंने उनका एक तो कैटेगरी स्पेसिफाई कर दी है, और साथ में उन्होंने बता दिया है जी कि ये गोल्ड कैटेगरी में लाए करता है, सिल्वर में है, प्लाटिनम में है, वो कैटेगरी भी कर दी है. जो डब्ल्यू कैटेगरी वाले हैं वो अच्छे में कंसिडर किए जाते हैं. तो इस तरह हम इनके एग्जैक्टली अगर मैं आपको एक्सप्लेन करना चाहूँ तो उसके लिए मेरे ख्याल से एक सेपरेट सेशन रखना पड़ेगा. लेकिन आप ये चीज़ मेनली याद रखें कि जी कैटेगरी को वो नहीं कंसिडर कर रहे हैं. वाई से ऊपर जो कैटेगरी है जिसमें डब्ल्यू एक्स वाई आ गया आपका, तो डब्ल्यू कैटेगरी के वो सबसे अच्छे वाले जो जर्नल्स हैं उनको कंसिडर कर रहे हैं. तो उन्होंने अपना पूरा पोर्टल कंपाइल कर लिया है. अगर किसी ने उसकी कैटेगरी चेक करनी हो कि आया ये HEC रिकॉग्नाइज्ड है, तो वो HERS उनका पोर्टल है, HERS.HEC.GOV.PK आई थिंक ये साइट है. अगर आप HERS को गूगल करेंगे तो आपके सामने वो पूरा आ जाएगा. उसमें सर और अगर एक्सप्लेनेशन देखें कि किन बेसिस पे की है, आई थिंक मैं उसके लिए आई एम अनेबल टू आंसर दैट. लेकिन ये है कि जी कैटेगरी जो है वो आपकी एक्सेप्टेबल नहीं होगी, वाई एक्स और डब्ल्यू जो है वो आपकी एक्सेप्टेबल होगी, और डब्ल्यू कैटेगरीज वाले जो है वो अच्छे जर्नल्स को उन्होंने उसमें उस कैटेगरी में रखा है.
शुक्रिया सर.
बाकी HERS पे जो है वो डिटेल्स उनकी सारे जर्नल की जो HEC रिकॉग्नाइज्ड है वो अवेलेबल है.
शुक्रिया सर. और कोई और की पार्टिसिपेंट मेंबर कोई क्वेश्चन या कमेंट करना चाहे? ओके, थैंक यू फॉर एवरीवन. एंड आई मस्ट से दिस सेशन वाज रियली यू नो फ्रूटफुल फॉर एवरीवन. सो थैंक यू फॉर ऑल टू ज्वाइन द सेशन, एंड नाउ वी विल साइन ऑफ दिस सेशन.
ओके, थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू एवरीवन.
Thanks.